proximity. But you can look at a map of the United States and see where the natural resources are most abundant in the wood parts of the country. But all of those things that, many of those policy choices that I think through, you see the map filling in and pursuing, those are all part of the groundwork for this area. And then part of it will be solar, part of it will be wind, but none of it will happen with that intention and goal. So during the campaign, I was the only candidate. I'm not sure if any of you tuned into the early presidential debate. They're kind of hard to find. We didn't debate in prime time for some reason. Often they were scheduled behind NFL playoffs and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. But if you tuned in, you would see that I was the only candidate to educate that we set a national goal of 100% clean electric grid by 2050. It's hard to imagine, isn't it, if an existential threat like climate change were known back in the 60s, that Dwight Eisenhower or John Kennedy wouldn't have picked the point on the horizon, marshaled our industry, our smarts, our creativity as a nation to achieve it. And admittedly, some of these things we don't know exactly the answer for, but it can happen, and it's happening every day. We were actually ahead of our goals on our renewable portfolio standard. And you don't know until you start which ones overperform, which ones underperform. You have to constantly go back and re-examine your plans, be open to new technologies and new ways of doing things. But a big part of it is also the re-design of our built environment. I don't know if you see this, certainly you see it in your industry, but it's also happening in healthcare and other things as well. Move away from the big centralized institution to distributed generation, whether that distributed generation is a well-being and health, or whether it's knowledge, or whether it's even in many cases manufacturing. So I ramble. Hope that answers your question.
Indeed. I'd like to ask another question about built environment. Codes clearly set the floor, right? They represent kind of the minimum to which we can build while still being legal. But if you look at where codes have brought us versus where our climate targets are, there's a big chasm between where we are today and where we need to be even by 2020, 2030. Do you have ideas, or are there things that you have implemented in your state that have been effective tools for bridging that gap?
Yeah, sure. And I know you're going to be hearing from other nation leading mayors later on today, but the way I conceptualize it is all of those things, green building codes or requirements that your state dollars only go into the buildings of a certain energy efficiency standard. Those are things that every city and every county and every state are starting to do. And now on the bell curve of things, this wave of change that's coming, there are some people that are laggards and kind of behind the wave. There's other people riding the wave. And there's other cities that are in front of the wave. And our job as thinking citizens is to push our counties, to push our cities, to push our state leaders to constantly move the standards to the front end of that wave and thereby bring the others along. I learned when I was mayor of the city of Baltimore, we earned the Kennedy School Award for Innovation and Government. And I joke that the big innovation was that for the first time ever in city government, we started measuring the outputs of city government rather than its inputs. Which in the old days, cities, that was the only way you did it, right, Mayor? The annual budget. Mayor Mark Morial of New Orleans once said to me, kid, if you ever want to hide something, make sure you put it in the city charter or the city budget. Nobody ever reads either one. But increasingly, mayors this one, clearly there was a connection between the length of this drought and climate change and changing weather patterns, but then drove people off of their parched farms, drove them to cities. The government couldn't accommodate their needs for the basics of food, mentioned water and other things. And that led to the cascading events, protests, repression, that now continues in this downward spiral of the failure of the nation state of Syria. It is for that reason, that's one example, but our national security advisors are very deeply concerned about climate change and the effects of this on our natural resources and what that will do to our the stability of our geopolitics, the nation states and the like. They plan, they do the scenarios on these sorts of things. So I was kind of surprised when Bill O'Reilly and some other bright lights scoffed and guffawed about this. But it is true. And not to recognize it is to walk into a dangerous world with your eyes closed. So this is part of the transformation that transforms everything. I mean, we can't, you don't have a change like this without it affecting every aspect of our lives, including our security and our politics and the stability of this of nation states.
Wonderful. So I've got a few questions from our audience.
By the way, these are more questions than Anderson Cooper ever asked me.
Even more than energy, by far, water availability is the true limit to growth, especially in the expanding population of the American Southwest. How do we focus our national dialogue on water?
Regretfully, there's not a lot of discussion about any water issues, really. I can't remember. Can you remember a single water question? Being asked in the general, maybe a flood question. Look, this is a huge challenge for the planet. Just as we need to have some national goals on a clean energy grid, we need some national goals where water is concerned. Regions are trying to figure this out on their own, and I believe the federal government can play a role in this. In different places, it's different answers. One thing's true across the board. We use far too much water, waste far too much water as Americans, and there are technologies that can help us solve this. Better use of gray water, the capturing and impoundment of water, and some cities, out of a survival necessity, are figuring out this stuff ahead of others. I'm excited and I need to learn more about what Las Vegas is doing and some other cities. But we need a national agenda on this. Water is, I agree with the call of the card there.
Can we afford to wait until 2050 to accomplish some of our climate goals, or do we need to act with more urgency?
I said earlier that the difference between a dream and a goal is the deadline. But you don't hit your goals by waking up the night before the deadline. And say, oh, God, I got to hit my goal. Well, actually, that's how I got through law school. But no, we have to work today. You have to work right now. I mean, this is a colossal challenge. You have to constantly go back, refine your plans. You have to be radically open and transparent, let the public know, which is one of the tougher things that people in public service have to confront today. How in a trivial society where political journalism has oftentimes been reduced to nothing but tabloid entertainment news, how do you present and communicate to the people you're leading the things you're doing that are actually working, whether or not you're on track to hit the public goals, or even what the public goals are? I thought when we started announcing, we had 16 public goals as governor, three of them were energy, one of them was cleaning for the Chesapeake Bay. Honestly, that had been 36 overall, so I was kind of cheating on that one. I thought that the press and the media would want to play along and announce what our goals were and what the deadline. seems not to be much of an appetite in the media for reporting on what government is actually doing. So no, we can't wait. We have to go now. And I think what you're going to see, especially with our federal government sidelined, I think you're going to see more progress in the next 4 years by people taking action locally. And I think that the politics of that is going to be very beneficial for those mayors, for those county executives, for men and women that are serving as governors, that ride out and push the envelope towards that horizon.
Thank you. During the upcoming Maryland legislative session, your state will be considering a ban on fracking. What are the chances of this ban passing, and how do we address this issue on a national scale?
I would think that the chances of it passing are pretty good. On my way out of office, with my successor vowing to bring fracking to Maryland, we put forward regulations that were the toughest in the country to protect our water, protect our air, zero methane emissions. And we did that intentionally because we anticipated